A special night for him, but Spurs win the shootout in Molineux.
Hello everyone and welcome back to Tottenham Hotspur Stadium. Welcome along to N17 Live, wherever you are all over the world. It's great to have you along with us as we look ahead to another exciting European night under the lights as Spurs for the first time take on NS Mora. It's also our first ever game in the Europa Conference League group stages here at home. We currently sit second in Group G after that draw against Rennes last time out, but have the opportunity to potentially go top tonight with a good result. Lots to look forward to on the show this evening. We'll have the team news as well as the player arrivals very, very shortly, and we'll be doing that in the company of our club commentator Rob Daly as well as our club journalist Milesy. So lots to look forward to, and not long to go now until Spurs take on NS Mora. So welcome down to pitch side. The Spurs take on NS Mora tonight. As you can see, it's a gorgeous night here under the lights, as it always is in any of the big European nights. And I'm joined down at pitch side by our club journalist Milesy. Just made it, Milesy.
Literally with seconds to spare.
Superb. And our club commentator Rob Daly. How are you, Rob?
I was here on time, Ben. I think it's worth pointing out.
You camp out. You're like one of those people who can't get into Wimbledon. You camp out overnight.
Exactly.
Just in case. Itching
Absolutely.
At the door, waiting to get in. Milesy, I know I say it every single time, but I love the European nights here. Yep, it's so special, isn't it? Under the lights, even just being out here tonight, you come out, it's gorgeous,
yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah, and you walk to the stadium and you're thinking about those great glory nights, aren't you? And you're just thinking, oh, something could happen tonight. And it doesn't matter what the fixture is. I mean, I remember Harry scoring a hat-trick and Lamela's Rabona. That was against Asterix Tripolis. So... yeah, you never know what's quite going to happen. This time last year, was it 7-2, wasn't it, against McCarthy?
Yeah.
So there's always something in these European nights, yeah.
And we've already had a bit of a journey here as well, haven't we? We've had a couple of games in the Europa Conference League already, Rob.
That's right, yeah.
Building a bit of momentum now. It's important that it keeps going tonight.
It certainly does. I mean, you know, we've predominantly seen a slightly different team in the Conference League. We've seen that in the Carabao Cup as well. They've been similar teams that Nuno's used so far, so... you know, again, it's an opportunity for those players, and we love seeing Spurs in all white on European nights. It's always special. And let's see if the players can give the fans, you know, reason to go home happy.
Yeah, no, I mean, the team news will be out very, very shortly. But, like, we can say, first up, very, very exciting that Austin will be starting in goal. Wow. So what a huge opportunity that is, Milesy, tonight.
Oh, that's brilliant. That's brilliant. It's so difficult for young goalkeepers to get a chance because obviously you've got someone like Hugo. I mean,
who gets a chance?
World Cup winning captain. Yeah. And obviously we've had the likes of Michel Vorm here. Pierre comes in this season. Very, very good goalkeeper. Which leaves the third goalkeeper, often a young goalkeeper, sort of stranded there a little bit, doesn't it? So I'm absolutely delighted if that's the case and he gets his chance.
I think it was good, you know, because Alfie Whiteman was so good in pre-season, wasn't he? And I think it was good for him to get out on loan and get some game time, because off the back of pre-season, you're like, he needs to be playing a little bit. And for you, Milesy, I mean, you're down at the training ground lots.
I've just given it the big talk up, and it turns out he's not starting. He's going to be on the bench.
No.
That is such a shame. So it will be Gallini starting. But, I mean, what Milesy said still stands, right, in the sense that we come into these games, it's so, so hard for people to break into this team. It's so hard for a third-choice goalkeeper to try and get even a bit of game time.
No, it is. And as I was just about to say to Milesy there, because you're at the training ground way more than, you know, me, And it must be so rewarding to see these guys you speak to, you know, in pre-season friendlies, international Champions Cups. I remember seeing you interview like Skippy and all that like 4 years ago. To see them break into the first team, like on a personal level, you must love seeing these guys get into the team.
It's the best thing ever, seeing them come through the academy, because you build that relationship. I mean, Harry's a classic one, but all the ones, you know, that went alongside Harry, like Ryan Mason, I watched him come through the academy. I interviewed him at under 21 games. End of last season, he's managing the team.
Incredible. How many more of those?
Absolutely brilliant, yeah. And fully deserving of it.
So many more of those journeys, hopefully, that we'll see this season. Players arrived a short time ago. So Spurs coming into this one with a little bit of a breather from the Premier League, which is probably what we needed. 25 goals in our last 7 European outings at home, which is just incredible. Clean sheet in all of the last 6 in Europe at home, and we've won our last 5 in Europe as well. So the record is really, really good under the lights here at Tottenham Hotspur Stadium. No doubt some rotation tonight. We're going to come into the team news fairly shortly, but as we said at the top of the show, it's so crucial, isn't it, that you win your home games and you make sure that you give yourself the best possible chance to try and sew up the group at an early stage.
100%, the home games are the absolute key to European football. That's nice. You're generally thinking 10 points will be enough. So if you win your home games, yeah, and we are generally outstanding at home, then nick a couple of points away. We've done that against Stade Rennais, which was the toughest game in the group. Yep. We think Stade Rennais away, they were decent side, that was tough.
And what an atmosphere,
yeah,
as well.
Fantastic atmosphere, decent team. So you think perhaps nick another point away from, say, at Mura and win your home games, we should be...
We saw it last year, didn't we? We saw it last season in the Europa League when... Was it the second game where Spurs went to Royal Antwerp and lost?
Yes.
And Antwerp were excellent that day. And how tough it can be, but Spurs won all their games here and that was enough to win the group. Miles, right, 10 points, albeit for a very small number of cases ever in the history of European football, does not get you through. So win your home games and you're through, basically, yeah.
Well, let's talk a little bit about Enes Mura, because they come into tonight with a fascinating story. If you haven't seen much of them, as I'm sure a lot of people haven't, they were only formed in 2013-14 and they've had an incredible rise over the course of the last 8 years. They won the equivalent of the Premier League in Slovenia last year, and this is the first time ever that they will be facing English opposition in European competition. So just to give you a little insight into how they made it into the Europa Conference League, they were in the Champions League playoff rounds, they went out there, and they then went through into the Europa League and went out of the qualifiers there, or in the playoffs there, and so they come down into the Europa Conference League. So by no means a pushover, and just got a little bit unlucky in the fact that they faced Ludogorets and Sturm Graz in their qualifiers to try and get through in those competitions.
Yeah, it's amazing actually when you look at their European games this season. They played Skendija from North Macedonia,
yep,
who we played last season, and they played Ludogorets, who we played last season. So there's that pattern there. I spoke to a Slovenian journalist this week, and he says, look, it's a small town, I think it's in the northeast of Slovenia, and he said they're a very proud club.
Right.
Very proud players, they fight for the badge. He said back home normally they'd play, they'd press. He said they'll have a lot more respect here for Spurs, and they might be a little bit more cagey, but he said one thing they will do is fight. They will fight every tooth and nail to come out of here with some respect. Well,
and this is the thing that we've seen, Rob, over and over again at times when the narrative leading up to a European game is Spurs should win this game as the better side, or the better side on paper. Teams turn up here because it's a massive opportunity. They see Spurs as an enormous game, and it's really, really exciting for them to come and show off what they've got.
I bet even on the journey up, when they start to see the stadium, you know, as you start to arrive into Tottenham, I bet they can't believe they're going to play here tonight. You know, it's an incredible arena for them to play their football. Premier League opposition, the potential to be playing some of the best players in the country. It is an opportunity, you know, for them tonight. And it was interesting hearing the head coach, Ante Szymanczyk, who was saying, you know, we are going to try and stick to what we do domestically. Whether that bears fruit, we'll see, because the issue is that won't necessarily be allowed if Spurs are too good for them. So we'll see if they do, by default, end up sitting back and trying to soak up and frustrate. Because, of course, a point for them here after losing their opening game would be brilliant.
Well, this is what I was going to ask, Marcy, just to finish up here. Is the fact that we've had the weekend that we've just had, there's no getting away from that. Spurs have got to play on the front foot tonight. They've got to dominate possession, and we've got to make chances, haven't we?
Yeah, everyone's hurting massively. We're hurting, the team's hurting, Nuno's hurting. You only had to watch his press conference.
Yeah.
And the way you do, the way you turn things around is to come out here tonight and perform. So they know that. They don't need us to talk about it. Let's just hope they can do that. And, you know, you don't want to be in a position where you're thinking, OK, let's turn up and score a few goals. It just don't work like that.
No.
But let's hope it does work out that.
Let's hope strategically it does. But let's get ourselves in the mood for some goals. It's time for 6 in 16.
Sandro doing what he does best. Here's Holby. Here's Jermaine Defoe into the area. Defoe scores. Lamela in space. Chance to run a Google over. Threaded through Soldado. He's onside. It's two. There's the free kick. It's in. Spurs have their goal back just as we were calling for it. Given away. Chance for Tottenham, it's opening up. Kane scores this time. Chedley. Trying to restore a bit of pride, perhaps. Goes for goal. Oh, it's a terrific shot. With three men closing him down. Here's Lamela. That's exquisite from Eric Lamela.
I could watch those European goals, Miles. I could watch them over and over and over. Some special ones in there. That Ramona, as you said, it's just perfect, isn't it? Every single time.
Honestly, and something will always happen in these games. Yeah. I mean, I remember Eric scored a hat-trick against Monaco just before Monaco really started turning it on in the Champions League. I remember we played him in the Champions League soon after that. There's always something in these games, and they're great nights. And you'll see a slightly different crowd tonight. A few youngsters, hopefully, will see us turn it on, and that's what we want.
Well, there will be some opportunities to turn it on tonight for those young players. So, let's give you that all-important Spurs lineup for this evening. So, it is Gallini in goal. It's Doherty at right back. It's Rodon and Romero in the centre-back positions, and Reguilon at left back. And then Ali, Skip and Winks make up the midfield. So a return to the team for Winksy and for Skip as well. Dele Alli captains the side. Lo Celso, Scarlett and Brian Hill in the front three. Now, Rob, straight away, what jumps out at you there? Who are you thinking? I'm going to keep my eye on them this evening.
Yeah, Brian Hill, I think, you know, he had an excellent performance here against Paços de Ferreira in the playoff round for this competition. I think all the glimpses that we've seen of him, Spurs fans are excited. He was speaking in the presser as well, wasn't he, ahead of the game this week, saying, I've been told I've got to bulk up, I've got to get more physically ready for the Premier League, and I need to learn English. He was also asked about his Beatles haircut, which he said he's just had since he's been 10 years old. So, I'm really excited to see what he does. I think I want to see Christian Romero get up to the speed required to have him as a regular starter in the Premier League as well. Nuno knows he needs to get minutes in his legs. Disrupted start to his Spurs career through injury and then the isolation period. So I think they'd be the two new signings. You know, I've always got an eye on the new signings of those two, I think.
I'm going to be incredibly optimistic and positive and say here that the weather is going to make the pitch zippy, which will suit Spurs, as opposed to it's starting to rain and getting a bit ugly down here at pitch side for us. Let me just remind you of the team news for our opponents tonight. It's Obradovic in goal, Gorenc, Marusko and Karnicic at the back. Now, it's a back three, so as Milesy said, I think we're expecting here that they will just sit in a little bit more. Sturm, Kazar, Horvat, Lorbeck and Kuss in the midfield. So midfield five or wing backs, depending on how you look at it. And then Marasa Amalhalasjanovic up front. Apologies, my pronunciation was absolutely
ropey. No, some of those
there.
Are
but
pretty
Rob,
tough.
Rob, I don't envy you tonight. You've got your work cut out, haven't you?
I certainly do. Yeah, no, I mean, look, they lost on match day one. They deservedly lost to Vitesse. They were second best in that game, gave up a load of chances. I think Vitesse are a really good team. I've seen a lot of them in the Eredivisie. And they'll be, you know, hoping to be able to squeak into the through the group, but Mura will need a much better performance if they're to compete with Spurs here. Sometimes goalkeeper can be a little loose with his distribution. Karnicic at centre back is an international. Most of the Slovenia squad play outside of Slovenia. Credit to him, he's in the national team squad now, so they do have quality at centre back as well.
Should we just pick up on a couple of Spurs players then? I suppose the first one that I'd love to talk about is Dane Scarlett. Someone that during pre-season we got a little bit of a glimpse at. Ledley King speaks incredibly highly of him every time that we have Ledley on the show. But tonight for Dane, you think it's about taking that chance. I remember, Rob, we watched that VT with him, didn't we, where he said he regretted that first touch in the Europa Conference League.
Was it Ludogorets?
I
forget who it was, wasn't it?
It was down here.
Down right behind us.
And he said he replayed that moment over and over in his head. The question is, you know, is he ready? Is he ready to play in this game tonight? You know, we've seen there was all that enthusiasm around Troy Parrott at the time. When he came in, you then saw, he needs a bit more experience with Dane. He didn't get a touch against Passos. That was a byproduct, really, the way the team played, not the way that he played. So maybe an opportunity at home. How he'd love to score down this end as well tonight. And, you know, Spurs want a viable backup option at centre forward other than Sonny, you know, for Harry Kane. So let's see if Dane can do something here.
I mean, this is where stories can start, isn't it? Bottom line. We can go back to 2014 and Harry, and I'm not saying for one second that Dane is going to follow in Harry's footsteps here, but Harry started playing in Europa League, he started scoring goals in Europa League, he started scoring goals in League Cup, and eventually he forced his way into Mauricio's planning. Who's to say Dane can't score here tonight, and he can't score in the next one, and he can't score in the next one, and then you're on your way, and we'll see how far it takes him. But it starts tonight.
Yeah, absolutely. And let's talk a little bit more about the front line that he's a part of, because Gio Lo Celso's in there. Important for Gio to sort of continue to try and build some form. We saw over the course of the weekend when Spurs sort of went with a more out-and-out front three, we kind of lost a little bit of that craft, didn't we, Rob? And important for Gio tonight to kind of, I suppose, send a bit of a message almost.
Yeah, I think, you know, we need to see him step up this season. Season three for Gio. I think he'll know that as well. I actually fought against Chelsea in that first half that's largely been forgotten. He was excellent. And in part, I think, because he was not a conventional forward. He was popping up in little pockets and getting the ball off Ndombele and being really effective. We know he's not really a winger, is he? But we're going to see him in a front three tonight on that right-hand side. And I think Spurs also need another attacking midfield option. Lamela Bale out in the summer, only Brian Hill in, leaves a bit of a spot. If Lo Celso can play in that kind of role, that's a really good option for Nuno as well.
Another one who we've got to speak about is Brian Hill. We'll do that very, very shortly, but he caught up with Spurs TV earlier on this week.
¿Qué tanto te has acoplado a este nuevo entorno? ¿Cómo vas?
Bueno, pues la verdad que muy feliz de estar aquí. Los compañeros, el cuerpo técnico y el club me han dado una bienvenida estupenda desde el primer día que llegué. Me siento muy arropado y, como te he dicho antes, me siento muy feliz de estar aquí.
La siguiente pregunta, ¿qué opinas del fútbol inglés hasta ahora, de lo que has visto?
Bueno, yo creo que es un fútbol con mucho más ritmo. Creo que me tengo que seguir adaptando a la Premier y al ritmo de partido de aquí, pero es un fútbol muy bonito y muy disfrutable.
La siguiente pregunta, además del fútbol, ¿cómo va tu vida en Inglaterra? ¿Qué tal te estás acoplando? ¿Qué opinas?
Bueno, pues estoy intentando aprender el idioma. Me cuesta un poco aún entender y, sobre todo, hablar, pero creo que me vendrá bien aprender un idioma más y poder vivir esta experiencia aquí en Londres.
¿Y qué tan importante ha sido para ti el que tengas a tantos hispanoparlantes ayudándote a integrarte mejor?
Bueno, pues eso fue muy importante. También quiero agradecerle desde aquí a Rey, que fue el que estuvo hablando más o menos con él de cómo era esto, de cómo iba, y él me aconsejó muy bien y me ha acogido muy bien. También los demás compañeros. Y yo creo que eso es un paso importante para mí, en la decisión que tomé de venir aquí, porque siendo tan joven, yo creo que eso ayuda, que alguien que ya haya coincidido contigo en el vestuario esté aquí, me ha ayudado bastante a decidir esta decisión, aunque no fue todo por eso.
Regresando a la cancha, te hemos estado viendo jugar la semana pasada en Europa y en la Copa Carabao, y ahora te preguntamos, ¿qué impacto tuvo en tu seguridad el anotar un penal tan contundente en Molino?
Bueno, yo creo que como todo futbolista, cada gol o cada asistencia o cada victoria le da un plus a su confianza, y yo creo que es lo que me ha dado más confianza y más seguridad en mí mismo, y eso también es gracias a los compañeros y al cuerpo técnico.
Y regresando al partido que tienen con Mura, ¿qué importante va a ser para ustedes recuperarse?
Bueno, pues como tú dices, otra oportunidad más de volver a la victoria. Yo creo que el fútbol, lo bonito que tiene es eso, que juegas cada dos o tres días, no hay tiempo para lamentaciones, y creo que debemos hacer un buen partido, ganar y demostrar que hemos mejorado y que hemos trabajado para llegar a la victoria.
Nosotros tenemos una gran tradición de fútbol europeo. ¿Cuál es la meta que tienen ustedes para la temporada de la Europa Conference League?
Bueno, pues yo creo que está bastante clara. Yo creo que todo jugador quiere ganar todos los partidos, y lo que supone eso es ser campeón de la Conference League.
¿Y cuáles son tus esperanzas particulares para esta temporada?
Bueno, pues espero adaptarme del todo, conseguir minutos, conseguir la confianza del míster y aportar al equipo todo lo que esté de mi parte.
Y finalmente, ¿tienes algún mensaje para los fans?
Bueno, que estés tranquilo, que estamos trabajando en los errores, que como te he dicho, lo que ha pasado ya no se puede cambiar. Lo que sí vamos a cambiar es es los fallos que tuvimos y que estoy seguro que mañana vamos a ganar y el domingo también.
Okay, so plenty to look forward to tonight, but we're going to remind ourselves of the goals that we've scored so far in Europe and how we've got to this point. So obviously the qualifier against Passos de Ferreira first, and Brian Hill played an incredibly important part in those first 30 goals, Miser. So he makes this brilliant run behind and lays on for Harry. And I remember at the time saying, well, maybe Harry doesn't start so well traditionally.
It's great to see, it was good. I mean, this was good for Brian, wasn't it? So, and it was great to see him talking yesterday. I say I was in there and he came in. He's a young lad, but he's brimming with confidence by the look of it. And that some key, I mean, you mentioned it in a preview we do on the website about how important that penalty would have been for him in the shootout at Wolves.
In the League Cup.
Popped it in the top corner. I mean, that's for a young lad, that's got to do wonders for your confidence. And over at that place on Sunday, I think he was just about the only shining light there, wasn't he? I mean, he came on
and
he was bright. He wanted to get forward. He wanted to get involved.
Created the goal. I mean, that bit of intensity.
That was it. It was his persistence. I mean, we saw him chasing down the ball for that goal there. It was his desire to win the ball back. You know, he's the kind of player that probably Poch would have loved as well. You know, that work rate, that desire to chase things down. So, you know, I'm really glad to see him in the starting 11.
Well, he played a part in the second goal as well in that game. Let's just fly through the next two goals. So, the second goal, again, he plays his part. And again, Harry getting into a really good position. And I think this is the thing, right, is that we need to get those players into those positions, don't we, where they can be on the front.
And he's so progressive. I mean, as I say, we're looking at the screen now, and he picked the ball up 30 yards out. And he wants to drive forward, doesn't he? It's his first
great
motion
lines.
Is to drive forward. And that's what we want to see from him. Stay, you know, stay doing that. Beacock, we can see in it now. Look, get forward, look.
And
positive pass. We want to see that from him tonight.
Rob, we mentioned Gio a little bit earlier on. I mean, he was very, very unlucky not to get on the score sheet for the third goal as well, wasn't he? He took the free kick, and there was just a little nick off the defender, and it went down as an own goal.
Mate, I checked it on UEFA's website recently, and they had it listed to him.
Oh, did they?
But then I've seen other places say that he hasn't scored a goal this season. But he actually tried this twice, didn't he, I think, on the night, and this one came off.
I think that's going in.
That's so harsh.
To him, surely. But yeah, he was in the mood that night. It was a very good performance from Gio. He's had some good European performances. Four of his five goals last season were in the Europa League rather than in domestic football, and the Premier League goal against City down here. So, another chance for him in the team.
Yeah, and another person who was a little bit unlucky to get an own goal given instead of their goal. Lucas Moura against Rennes. So let's move on to those goals. This was such a good move. And, I mean, I know Lucas is potentially going to square this here, but there's so much of the good work that came before, wasn't there, Mars, with the back heel from Ndombele, the ball around the corner from Harry.
Yeah, we just missed the back heel from... There it is. There's the back heel from Tonga, yeah. This is a lovely move. And... yeah, it'd have been nice for him just to slide it across goal and let Stevie B tap it in. That would have been nice, wouldn't it? Because, Stevie obviously out now. We could do with a goal. But tough night that night. So I think once we see the group as a whole, after we've played six games, we'll probably look back on that and say, yeah, that tour was all right.
It's a weird, it's one of those, isn't it, where you come away at the end and you see the second goal and come away and think two all. Because of the nature of it, it feels almost disappointing.
And Nuno said that. I mean, he never... really minces his words, does he? If he thinks things were bad, he will say. If he thinks they were good, he will sort of say. You know, he'll try and keep things cool. But he seemed happy with the point. And given the way that Ren grew into the game, they grew in confidence, didn't they, on the night, took the lead. I wasn't sure if Spurs were going to get their way back into it.
Not forgetting we lost two players as well.
But Steven Bergvall and Lucas Moura both coming off. Emerson Royale at right wing in a front three. And then, obviously, Pierre-Emile Højbjerg doing the rest.
Lots of people getting in touch in the comments asking tonight how many subs that we're allowed. So it's five tonight, and you may see on the right hand side of the screen, you can see all the subs coming up. One more that's on there, 49, Toby Amoli, is also on the bench for Spurs this evening. Rob's just mentioned there, Pierre-Emile Højbjerg got the second goal, and I mean, what a lovely finish this was for someone who's not known for his goal scoring.
Yeah, he does really well. We're quite composed at the end there. Little touch. Yeah, I mean, I'd have had a nice swing on my right foot and it would have gone up there somewhere.
Nice big air shot.
It would have gone up there somewhere.
But it did feel like we needed it at that point, didn't it?
Oh, 100%. We didn't want to come out of here losing, for sure. And I said, I've just said it, at the end of it, this would be a decent point. But Pierre came off the bench, didn't he, after one of the subs.
And, he
helped bring us back into this game. So.
Well, that was around the sort of 70, I think it was 73rd minute.
He's got that in his locker. You know, if he, obviously he's playing in a holding defensive role, but if he was to push on in a game like, you know, if he was playing tonight, but in a game like tonight, you'd probably see him around the box and doing it.
We've seen the semi, Miles, when Skip's played, and sometimes Skip's the guy holding, and then you've got Dele and Højbjerg either side, and Højbjerg will break into the penalty area. Had that great goal against Wolves last season as well down that end. You know, he can do that, and that was a lovely finish.
I think that's probably it's kind of like our blessing and our curse at the moment, isn't it? The idea that you've got two great holding players in there in Skip and Højbjerg that can do such a brilliant job for you, but then at the same time we're all looking and thinking, oh, we want to play on the front foot.
This,
you know,
this is the question I think at the minute, Ben. It's how do you balance the midfield right?
Yeah.
You know, because there's all that creative talent. You want to get Dele in there, we know he's been industrious. You've got Tongi in there, you've got Gio who can play in there, but then you've got the solid guys like Skip and Højbjerg, and the midfield looks a bit more settled when they're in there. But then you do lose those back heels from Tongi if he's not in the team. This is the big thing, I think, for Nuno right now, the issue to address, how to balance that central midfield. We saw it against Arsenal, came undone in that first half a little bit. Need to try and just work out what that should be going forward.
Let's just talk very quickly about the defence as well. Kind of final thing that I think we need to touch on. Tonight is all about keeping a clean sheet for those guys, isn't it? I mean, you look at a number of those players that are coming in and getting game time tonight, haven't played that much. It's so important to try and keep confidence high and get a shutout tonight, isn't it?
That's what they're measured by, isn't it? I mean, Pierre Galina will go mad if he concedes a goal tonight. That's what you're judged on as a defensive unit. I agree with Rob. I think it's brilliant to see Christian in there. We need to see him play games. We need to see him. I think he looks the part. I think he looks the business.
Yeah.
But he obviously he needs to get minutes under his belt.
You know what else? He sort of has, I think, that separates him. He's a front foot defender, very similar to Jaffet. And I think you almost need that aggression in the Premier League, don't you? You need that player who's not afraid to go out and meet people.
Yeah, I mean, and look, Hackett, you can't underestimate the award of Serie A Defender of the Season.
Yeah.
I mean, come on, that is his credentials right there. So
everyone who works on that league has been asking me how he's doing. And obviously he hasn't played a great deal yet because it's been this sort of staggered start to the season. But they all want to know. Everybody says he was fantastic. He was unbelievable last season. And Atalanta conceded loads of goals because they are an attacking team. And he still won Serie A Defender of the Year. So, you know, a lot of clubs wanted him. It was great Spurs got him.
We just put it down to circumstances at the moment, don't we? I mean, circumstances have gone against him and Nuno. So hopefully this will be the start tonight.
Yeah, and I mean, these international breaks just, they just keep popping
up.
There's
another one coming up.
Another one coming around the corner.
Days, yeah.
Just a very quick one, guys. Firstly, how's it going to play out? Score prediction?
3-0 Spurs, Brian Hill to score.
There you go.
I'm going to go more than three.
More than three, 3+ on your coupons.
As I say, I'm very reluctant to sort of just assume it will happen like that. But I've seen us play in these home games before in Europe, and we tend to be very good. So early goals, Ben. That's the key.
Yeah, absolutely. Guys, thank you so much for joining the pitch side.
Pleasure.
Cheers, Ben.
If you're watching along at home on N17 Live, no post-match show for you today, but we will be back for the pre-match for Aston Villa. So really, really exciting game ahead on Sunday that's coming up. If you're in the stadium, we're going to leave you with live coverage of the Leicester game that's going on at the moment. And a quick reminder, if you do want to follow along the action with the action on social media, it's at Spurs Official on Twitter and on Instagram. You can also follow us on all of the others, TikTok, Twitch, Facebook and YouTube as well. In the meantime, though, enjoy the game wherever you are in the world. Make sure you get behind the boys and fingers crossed. It's another big 3 points for the Spurs tonight.